Yep. So first of all, I'm really not an expert, and it's really just my approach based on my experience and personal research. And you'll find that, you know, over the years, literally, I've just gone through so many different things, read so many different books, because I'm always just trying to find out how I can perform better, be more productive, and also just be happier and be, you know, just feel better in myself. So I think that's one of those things about being a medical person. We're just naturally a bit more like discontent. We're not always content with things, and that's what helps us to strive. So what I'm really just trying to share with you is an approach that I've compiled over a lot of time, and hopefully it's something that's useful for you guys. So in this, I'm sure there's going to be some people who know a lot of this stuff and who know a lot of stuff as well, just based on their own experience and their reading. So really, I'd love if you would share your experience. And if you catch me on something that's not quite accurate, please let me know. That's completely fine as well. So I'm hoping that we'll be able to share some stories and ideas. I definitely will be sharing some of my experiences. And just know that, you know, I believe obviously everyone here is intelligent, capable, and cares about doing their best. And, you know, you all want to improve. You want to pass the exam and become gun anaesthetists in the future and do some great patient care and live some good lives. So that's where we're all coming from. Now, Fight Club rule, obviously the personal stuff we share with each other is completely confidential. You notice I'm recording this, but absolutely nothing that you say or no images of you will be recorded. So literally I'm just recording it for the sake of the talk. But anytime I do interactions, that stuff will get edited out completely. So there'll be nothing, not your voice, not your video at all during this talk. And the first thing I've just noticed that Stan's logged on. I just want to really thank Stan for asking me to do this talk, because I've been meaning to cover this stuff in a holistic way for a very long time. When I think about all the stuff that I've learned over the years, during my first part, during my second part, even just during my uni days, and especially now that I'm doing far more teaching, the fact that I've got to do this talk for you guys today meant that the last week I've just been preparing it and trying to put all my ideas together in one cohesive fashion. And if you've ever been to any of my talks, you know, I'm all about structures and frameworks. And I was thinking, oh, well, you know, this is the time that I need to actually get a framework for this exam as well. Well, thanks, Dan.
Thanks. I really appreciate your wealth of experience and expertise. And as I said, you are an inspiration not only to me, but to a lot of the trainees as well. So thank you so much for doing this session. Really, really appreciate it. We are doing good things. We are raising funds for your charity as well. Hey.
I wish Fred Hull was with my charity, but you know. And also, where's my invite to the zoo? What's going on? I'll teach indoors. You go to the zoo. Good. I'll give you a bit of my background. In the context of this, I was brought up in a Sri Lankan Buddhist household. And what's interesting is my parents were really into Buddhist philosophy, and they weren't just cultural. I mean, initially they were just cultural Buddhists, but they really got into it. But when I think about how much they meditate and how much they just, you know, really, really focus on a simple life and mindfulness, and they, you know, my parents would meditate on average 1 hour a day at least. But I couldn't have a bar of it. I just did not see the use of it. It just seemed like a waste of an hour to me, which is quite ironic, because then as things got more and more high intensity and high risk and very involved, like, you know, my life is ridiculously busy these days. I think we have this thing that we're, especially medical people, we just keep adding on stresses and challenges to our life. And then at a certain point I realized, okay, I really need to sort this out. And I was talking to one of my mates who was telling me that, you know, mindfulness and a few other strategies, these are some of the most evidence-based ways of dealing with stress and anxiety and low levels of, you know, sad states, depression, whatever it is. And that's when I decided, you know what, I'm going to try and start, you know, doing things now to prepare myself for the future. I jumped head on into it. Like I did a 10-day silent meditation retreat, which was probably one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. It was everything I hate, which is being silent, no talking, eating vegetarian food was difficult, nothing to eat after midday, waking up at 4 o'clock, sleeping at 9:30, no entertainment, no distractions, no reading, no writing, no exercise. I felt incredibly, you know, just horrible during that time. But the one thing it gave me was, it was, you know, you have to be alone with your thoughts. You have to deal with all those things that you may have not dealt with that come up time and time again, as you're sitting there for 10 hours a day with your hands in your lap, cross-legged, dealing with the pains of, you know, sitting there. I don't know if anyone's done it. Has anyone done a 10-day silent meditation retreat before? Yeah, look, as much as I say I'd recommend it, you've got to really, really want to do it. But that was a jump start for me when I realized, oh, this really worked, and it gave me a lot of things, and I'll tell you about that in a second. It became a thing where definitely the first part exam, the second part exam, and the ongoing stresses of consultant life were essentially the most unwell times mentally I was. And overall, you know, it was still pretty good, but I thought there's a place where I can be better at this and better at taking care of my mental health. You know, the first part exam, again, grueling, the second part exam, you know, I just constantly felt like I wasn't good enough. And, you know, that wasn't a great feeling to have. It meant that, you know, I was able to cope with certain things to spur me on, but, you know, I was lucky that I didn't have any extra stresses that could have, you know, taken me out of that point, but I had very little reserve. And then even in consultant life, you'll have lots of crises, but you also have these constant mini crises occurring. And that's what prompted me to do that 10 days of meditation, then read into this, because I thought I better invest in this. So you will slowly get these challenges if you're not already. And I hope that this kind of stepwise framework of strategies that I've kind of compiled it's not exhaustive. It's just something that I find really useful. So the goals for this, you know, at the very start, let's get an insight into your core values, insight and strategies to maximize wellness and happiness, insight and strategies to improve performance, and then build strategies and habits to succeed in all areas of your life. And, you know, again, don't just survive this exam. I really did feel like I just survived this exam, but I think there is a better place for this, to actually thrive in this exam. So why do we feel crap? And it's kind of this obvious question. I just want to throw it out there. Like, why is it that we constantly feel unsatisfied and, you know, stress? And what's the point of all of these negative emotions? Look, I often come back to biology because it's just so real to me. You know, we are a slave to our biology. You know, there's evolution, and life never owed us happiness. It just owed us a couple of things, you know, helped us to survive to the age of reproduction and to raise our future children to reproduce as well. So when I remember this Tim Minchin talk where he talks about, you're always going to be, you know, you're never going to be content. Just remember that content Homo sapiens watching his cave flicks in his cave didn't go out there to hunt animals, didn't go out there to mate and reproduce and fight for survival. And they died off, and those genes died off. And then the very unsatisfied Homo sapiens that just kept wanting to build more caves and hunt more animals and reproduce more, they're the ones that survived. And that's kind of our lot in life. We're a slave to our biology from that point of view. Now, there's a few other things, again, by no means not everything, but there's always a negativity bias as well in the way we perceive things. And again, this is a really good logical basis to it. If you were to think, how would you design an animal's mind to respond to threats and opportunities? You know, which one do you want more of a signal to? Where do you want more of a reaction for? And if you think of, you know, just a rabbit in the forest, you know, just doing its rabbit things, if it was to see something that maybe looked like a fox, would it be better that it ran away really scared rather than go to explore it? If we think of the implication of that fox and the potential fox and that rabbit, if the rabbit went and didn't react in such a ridiculous way to that potential negative state, the chances are that would be the end of that rabbit's life. So we respond to threats much faster and stronger, and they're much harder to inhibit than anything good. Now, if that thing that it saw wasn't a fox, but maybe an opportunity for food or mating, it just wouldn't be the same. It just wouldn't have the same implication. By running away, it would simply lose a meal, but it would still be alive and ready to fight the next day. So that's one of the things. We have this negativity bias, and anyone in a long relationship, anyone who's married will understand this. I think we've all been in this position where, you know, five good actions, I think, are the average required to make up for one critical action. So if you do something wrong by a partner, you really have to rebuild that trust again because we have this negativity bias. Now, there's also this adaptation principle. Often you might talk about hedonic adaptation. But if I was to ask you, you know, is winning the lottery or becoming a paraplegic better for your overall happiness? I think we'd all just think that was a pretty silly question. Of course, you'd want to win the lottery. There's far more options. But the evidence shows that within a year, most people are back to their baseline level of happiness. And this is almost impossible to even think about. But this is one of those realities. I think we'd all prefer winning the lottery because it gives us more options. But in reality, we just adapt. We grossly overestimate the intensity and duration of emotional reactions. Even passing this exam, you will think this is going to be the best thing ever. But the fact is that you'll probably in a couple of weeks' time just go, yep, pass the exam, next thing. And only through a few strategies such as, you know, gratitude, savoring, that we can, you know, thwart this hedonic style adaptation. Yep, so the human mind is very sensitive to changes, but not the absolute level. And this is one of those things you can hack through a deliberate practice and deliberate training, and something that I really try to do every day now, based on that evidence. So knowing these biological states and these biological facts about our nature means that we can accept it for what it is, and then we can use evidence-based strategies to mitigate these facets of human nature. So now this is where I'll get into the way I think about this stuff. And again, I was trying to really think about how to structure this. And I think it starts with values and identity and knowing what those are, well-being, and then further on performance and accountability. So we will go through the values, identity and well-being stuff in this lecture. And then in future lectures, we can definitely go through performance and accountability. So values and identity, really, what is your life mission? Who are you? Who do you want to be? And that really drives a lot of how you structure your life, your goals, your processes, all will link into your values and identity. So it's far better to change that and have good values than to start with your goals and start with your processes. Also well-being, now I'm going to, again, not an exhausted list, but I'm going to go through the things that I've read about over the years that I find most useful for me. So just a personal opinion, but things like perspective, mindfulness, CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy, affirmations, visualizations, some of these mental optimization strategies, gratitude and some Stoic philosophy. And that's what we'll go through today. So let's start with this values stuff. So this concept of values, I think, is really important because I think we all have values and we all think that we're into something. For example, you know, I think that, you know, my values are to take care of the environment, but sometimes these things don't align. Like if you want to take care of the environment and you know, drive a Hummer, it just doesn't align that well. So just remembering that when you choose these values, be aware that there may be a disconnect, that if you're, you know, if you really are just shopping with plastic bags constantly, you probably, and even though you say you care about the environment, you're probably not in the same realm of caring about the environment, and your values may be misaligned. Also that you are what you value. Now, if I take the example of someone who goes for a jog every now and again, maybe every 6 months, they're a person who jogs. But if you constantly are a person who runs every day or runs 3 times a week, then that embodies who you are and your run, and your mind will believe that that's what you are. Now, and I think we can hack this and we can think about this in the form of the exam as well. And this is going to be one of the first exercises we do. I think at the very start, you want to choose values that align with what you do, and then choose them as aspirational values as well. So there's some values that are better than others, and there's some values that are worse. And these good values are evidence-based, constructive, and controllable, whereas bad values might be emotion-based, destructive, or uncontrollable. So I want everyone to get like a pen and paper or your notes on your phone, because we're going to try and just go through some stuff again as it relates to the exam, because I think that's, you know, that's what we're here for. That's your major big challenge. So, you know, some good value examples: honesty, creativity, vulnerability, standing up for oneself, standing up for others. Whereas bad examples, unhealthy values, are things that are out of your control. For example, I want to be liked by everyone and I want to be popular is a bad example of a bad value, just because you have no control about what other people think. But standing up for others, being generous, these are good examples of values. Now, in the exam context, I want you guys to think of now, what are some good values to adopt for this exam? Make them constructive, make them controllable. Just write, you know, maybe 3 down as just to start with. And I might just get some volunteers to tell me what they come up with. So yeah, just take, you know, a couple of minutes to do that. And so just for everyone, I really like those again, because they're, again, evidence-based, constructive, controllable. They make sense that these are good values to have. And here's just a bunch of values that, you know, I think relate to this exam as well: generosity, vulnerability, creativity, curiosity, kindness, reliability, diligence, discipline, commitment, personal growth, collaboration, charity, supporting family. And I think, you know, you can think about this in the context of the exam itself, you know, collaborating and self-compassion and commitment and consistency. I think these are all really good. And you can also think about it in terms of, look, you know, this exam is just a really overwhelming quiz, you know, an overrated quiz. But at the end of the day, it means that you get to pass an exam, try to do a career that's really, you know, useful and worthwhile, and the things you can do with that career, whether it's for yourself to, or for your family or for your friends or for some other charitable thing. I mean, that's just a really, really good thing to be able to do. So there's all these different levels that you can have these good values based on. So once you've, you know, once you've got this identity or the inner level value type stuff sorted out, then we can talk about what are the outcomes and what are your actual goals, and then what are the processes to get you to that goal based on your identity. So kind of working from the inside out. So really there's a pretty easy method for this. Pick a value, set some goals that are aligned with that value, make some decisions and processes in such a way that takes you closer to those goals and experience the benefits of that value. And these will hopefully then inspire you to pursue it further. And then pick the next value and repeat. So I thought we'd just go through a couple of things. These are just a couple I've thought out, but you know, choose the ones that you've got on your sheet as well. So how would you set goals and processes for these values? Again, I reckon just take 3 minutes, and I might get someone to volunteer. Like literally, what would they do? You know, proper goals, smart goals, specific, measurable, achievable. And make sure that, and then we can share those goals and the processes that could get you there. Or just choose these ones: collaboration, generosity, and diligence or discipline. Good. I'll give you maybe 3 minutes for that. And in terms of like, because it's always related to study, so you're going to set up your environment to be conducive to study. So I imagine no distractions and have everything set up. So there's very little, this is like good habit formation. There's very little barrier to your study. Like you literally can sit down, lighting's right, pot plants there, candles, whatever you need. And how about like the daily routine of it? How would you manage the, the diligence or consistency aspect? What would you do to make it regular? And so from my point of view, it sounds good. First of all, it's a good value, you know, discipline. And I forget the other one you said, but let's say discipline and consistency. And as it relates to study, so what are your goals? Your goals are going to be to literally, I would like to, you know, study 1 hour every day, even if it's, doing the best I can for that. And what are my processes? And it sounds like your process is to make a good study space. Potentially, you know, you can add things on as well. Like I think you mentioned a lot of good things there, but adding on some level of accountability. Maybe you'll meet up with a study mate or call them up and make sure you're both on Zoom studying together to make yourself accountable, maybe having a logbook for that accountability. And I think that's really, really good. And to me, let's say collaboration is the value. My goal would be, you know, I want to meet up with a study group once a week, and maybe this is my personal experience. I remember I had a study group for once a week, but then I'd, just to keep myself accountable, I'd meet up with another mate on the side. And I had a few people I'd just meet up individually because it was easier to organize. And I had a timetable for that. So we actually just met up 5 times a week. And then the process to get there is literally making out a timetable to make sure that, you know, you're both free at certain times the week before, and you're not allowed to make excuses because you keep each other accountable. But I like that. I think what you're saying as well was to, for a more long distance thing, that, you know, you want to see opportunities as they come up and collaborate with them as well. So that's the first thing. There's a lot more with values and goal setting that will be in like a future lecture about performance and stuff. But any questions about the values before we move on? So yeah, quick summary, you know, values and identity. I think who you are and who you want to be, if you've got that in your mind constantly, you can think about the goals and processes that you can do to align with these, you know, values, and, you know, how can they relate to the exam? And I think that's one of the most beneficial, I think, things I've done recently. Which I didn't do as much. You know, I had very short-term goals when I was doing my training. Look, I just need to get this exam. I need to become an anaesthetist. And that was useful. But now as I've got older, you know, your work period, your post-exam anaesthetic adult life, you've got so much potential and so many opportunities that you can take on board. It's so important to make sure that everything you do aligns with these values, and you're constantly reassessing this. So I found this incredibly useful to think about it this way. But let's go straight to well-being, because now let's say you've got your values and you've got some goals and strategies and processes. So you're on this journey to try and get to where you want to be. You know that the fact that our biology means that we're never content, or we're rarely content, and we're always being, there's always other factors affecting our well-being. We need a strategy. And so this is basically what I kind of come up with based on, you know, reading and experience from the past. Firstly, mindfulness, and we'll go through that, mental optimization, and a few things to do with that, you know, perspective, affirmations, visualizations, emotions, CBT, a cognitive behavioral therapy, Stoic philosophy, Stoicism, gratitude, and then a lot of the other things that are, you know, supremely vital, but may not be talked about in the sense of well-being, which is just, you know, friends and GP and having a psychologist and things like that. So let's get to it. So mindfulness. Does anyone have a decent definition of mindfulness? I found that this was one of the trickiest things to really think about. But yeah, does anyone want to just volunteer a few thoughts about mindfulness and what it means to them? So I love that you mentioned present, and you mentioned, like, you know, essentially you're giving attention to the experience. And the other extra thing on that is that it's without judgment. So whatever happens in that moment, however you feel about it, like, you know, you just don't attach a value to it, that you just accept that your mind went there, and you know, whether it's good or bad, the thoughts, positive or negative, you just go, yeah, that's fine. So the process of purposely bringing one's attention to experiences occurring in the present moment without judgment. So what I thought we'd do now is just do 5 minutes of mindfulness meditation, just because it's a really useful thing to demonstrate a few examples. So obviously you might not be in the absolute perfect environment, but to me, mindfulness isn't, you know, sitting under a tree cross-legged with your hands like this. You know, this can be done anywhere at any time. What did you notice about your mind? Like, did it go to any strange thoughts or just unexpected thoughts? Does anyone have any unexpected thoughts that just came into their mind? And that's not, and I always think that's not a bad thing. Like, I feel like being immersed in something as important as this is not a bad thing, but having the choice to be immersed is important. For example, at the end of the day, going to bed and maybe just running through a few things that you've learned or writing them down, that's useful, I think. But then for it to become a repeat cycle where you can't go to sleep and you can't do anything about what you need to learn, that's a bad thing. So, you know, having that choice, that awareness of what's coming to your mind, and then going, yep, that's something I can address, or not, that's for later. And having that option feels like it's a very, you know, really powerful thing to be able to do. This is the power of mindfulness. Your brain knows what it wants to think about. It just starts thinking about it. You were apparently focusing on your breath, and then these thoughts that are very important to your brain come to your mind, and you know that, okay, well, I think I need to address this, because this is definitely something that's causing me a little bit of, you know, negative feeling or anxiety or, you know, mild stress or whatever. But hey, it's important to my brain. I better address it at some point. So I think that's really powerful that you can then go on to actually change it. And we'll probably talk about collaboration as we go through this. So I found that I can't really focus on my breath for that long. I'm constantly distracted, especially the more I have going on. It's not like at the peak of my meditation, I could be focused on my breath with no distractions for ages, but then that quickly gets undone as soon as I get back into the real world when there's constant distractions. So I think it's one of those things to accept that it's very hard to focus on your breath, but the advantage is, what does it mean to you? It gives you a lot of insight into what your mind is actually worried about, and gives you a choice about whether you can worry about that now and deal with it, or is this just a use, you know, a waste of your mental energy? So the people in this space that made this really good for me were people like Sam Harris, even the Headspace app. In the way they talk about mindfulness and the practical, very Western nature of how useful it is was very useful. The way I was brought up, I found it was probably not as useful. I didn't resonate with it as much. I'll show you the link to Sam Harris's app at the end of the talk. The stuff that he says is, you know, all emotions and thoughts are mental events. Whether you're angry, stressed, or happiness, they occur in your consciousness. And really, many mental responses are not recognized or acknowledged after a stimulus. The fact that you're meditating meant that you're aware of that thought coming in, but maybe you're just driving and, you know, you're in traffic, and then suddenly you're worried about the collaborative aspect, or you're worried about how much you need to study pharmacology. And you may not even notice it, but you'll be in this negative state because of it. Being aware of the contents of your consciousness allows you to note the emotional thought, and then you can pause. You can actually give it some space to consider your response and then respond or ignore it. And this is where all the power is of mindfulness, in my opinion. Everything good or bad that happens must appear in your consciousness to matter. And the training grounds for being good at this is your 5 to 10 minutes a day of mindfulness meditation. And that's what gives you that practice. So again, if you do 10 minutes a day and that's it, I don't see much use in that. But if you do 10 minutes a day or 5 minutes a day and then constantly think about it and are aware that you're trying to be mindful of the thoughts and the, you know, conscious thoughts that you do have, that is extremely useful. Also, if you're an evidence-based person, look, the evidence probably isn't the most amazing evidence. I acknowledge that, but what we're doing makes a lot of sense with mindfulness, but also some evidence does show long-lasting changes in attention, emotion, cognition, and pain perception, and that these correlate with structural and functional changes in the brain. So if you're an evidence-based person, great. Doing a little bit of this every day, hopefully will, you know, have some really long-lasting effects. And once you do this a lot, you see the, you know, the perpetuations of thoughts in other people as well. So, you know, you might have a, I remember I was traveling and I just met this person who, what is it? They started getting altitude sickness and they were so troubled by it. They just kept on saying it like it was on a broken record. I just want to feel better. I just want to feel better. And it, for the next hour, that's all this person was saying. And you will notice that this is clearly a very destructive and very not constructive way to think about something, that you cannot control this problem right now. And this one technique has many applications. You know, for example, your thoughts, as we mentioned, awareness and insights into the thoughts that arise, acceptance of these, then you can choose which thoughts to engage and consider and choose which thoughts you can let go because you can worry about them another time. Also sensations, you know, there's good evidence of being able to tolerate negative sensations and just, you know, accept them. Chronic pain is felt better, as well as stress. And then focus and performance. So, you know, being able to focus on one task and not be distracted because you've been training that. You've been doing a little bit every day and you're aware of distractions and you can, you know, get rid of those or table them for another day. You know, just if a thought is coming to your mind, just the fact that you can write it down on a piece of paper or on your notes means that you're already programming your brain to not think that it needs to worry about that in the future. So as I mentioned, it's not just, you know, sitting cross-legged like a monk under a tree, that this is real world mindfulness. You know, a lot of it is about being in that present moment because you're aware of what's happening now. You know, you might be laughing with some friends, you know, experiencing the warmth of, you know, being in your bed under the covers on a cold day, you know, you're outside with fresh air. And in those moments, you don't need to think about anything in the past that you can't change and anything in the future that you need to do that you can't do now. And so real world mindfulness is about being in these moments and really going, oh yeah, I'm happy as I am. I accept these things and I'm enjoying the time I've got now. And this will be especially important during something like this exam because it is all encompassing in your life and you really have to immerse yourself. But those moments where you're not immersing yourself is really useful. Likewise, then kind of the negative stuff, you're there in traffic and you've got a bit of road rage, or maybe you're extremely hungry after a reward round or doing a list that you didn't get a break for. Maybe someone slightly insulted you. Maybe you got a paper cut and you feel annoyed and angry at that. Maybe you feel some jealousy or sadness or other emotions. Being able to be aware of that, switch it off, acknowledge it, write it down, address it another time is really powerful. So the action I'd say is, you know, download one of the apps, whether it's Headspace, Calm, or Waking Up, really, really useful. And because they just guide you through it, it just feels quite nice to be able to do it. And then do 10 minutes a day. Has anyone downloaded one of those apps already? Headspace or, yeah, nice. And usually there's a free version of it. Otherwise, they're very cheap anyway, definitely within our, you know, realms of a registered salary. Okay, so that's mindfulness. Now, the other thing that really helped me during this exam was this concept of mental optimization. So mental optimization. I want you to think about, because you're now mindful of the thoughts that come into your mind, you can also rewire it in the sense or hack it in the sense that you want to actively occupy your mind with positive, useful thoughts. So why? Well, I'm sure you've all heard of this concept called neuroplasticity. It's the ability of the nervous system to change its activity in response to intrinsic or extrinsic stimuli by reorganizing its structure, functions, connections. So really, it's kind of like faking it till you make it in an active way with thoughts. So the ways that I think we can do this are perspective, words of affirmations, visualizations, and emotions. Now, first of all, perspective. I mean, this is probably one of the most self-evident things when you really think about it, that if you think of the history of humanity as it is, how are you doing? And just, you know, have a quick think. How are you guys doing compared to everyone who's ever lived on the planet? It's a bit of a facetious question, but you're a doctor, you're living in Australia or New Zealand, and even in this decade with COVID-19, you're probably still doing better than most people who've ever lived in human history. And we're talking about, you know, you've literally won the lottery. And anytime I'm a bit down, I really try to step back and think about that. And that really puts things in perspective for me. It's very hard in this exam because, again, it's so all encompassing and you're absolutely immersed in study and learning and everything. But it's always, you know, even if it's just writing on your mirror, you've won the lottery and you just kind of have a bit of a chuckle that, man, I was lucky to be in this situation is probably useful. So the activities that I think besides, you know, keeping perspective, so take time to occupy your mind with useful content. So address your particular weaknesses and strengths. And I don't know if you've heard of this, but there was this psychologist who wanted all of their patients just to say, you know, every day in every way, I'm getting better and better, and say that a few times in the morning at night. And he found that after studying this, those people that just said those words felt a lot better by saying those words. Even if they didn't believe it initially, you're actively occupying your mind with useful words. And we can hack that for this exam. Also visualizations, think about what visualizations you can imagine for this exam. So, you know, again, you can do this for any part of life, but for this exam, to just make yourself feel better and more positive and optimistic, because we know that a relaxed and content and positive mind performs better in the exam as well. And again, the study that they did was with basketballers. So three groups of same level basketball players, and the outcome was how many free throws that they could get in the net. And so the first group, so they've got a baseline for all the three groups. And then one group just practiced free throws for the next week, try to do as best as they could. The next group had no practice whatsoever. And the third group just had visualization. So all they had to do was every day visualize getting that ball in the net. At the end of the 3 weeks, you can imagine how they did. You could probably expect that the people that practice regularly physical practice actually did the best. But what happened was the visualization group and the practice group did exactly the same, whereas the group that didn't practice at all did worse. So visualizations can be incredibly powerful. I want you to think of that in the next exercise, and also what emotions you want to feel. So occupying your thought with what are the emotions that you want to feel when you're doing your practice exams, when you're doing your study, and when you do the real exam. So I thought we'd now take 3 minutes and literally just write down a set of words that relate to some aspect of the exam. Let's say some active of what you're probably doing now, which is some hardcore study. I want you to write down words, visualizations, and some emotions. And I might just ask for a volunteer for that. So take 3 minutes and go for it. I know that my negative self-talk during this exam was incredibly bad. I remember my dad, again, he'd bought this book called Mind Power by this guy called John Kehoe. And I thought, oh, this is just sounds like absolute, you know, crap. But my dad goes, you know, just read this. I remember reading it and it had some of the facts that I was telling you about. I thought, you know, I'm just going to give this a try. And literally this is what I did for the first part exam. I'd study something and I'd just feel a bit down maybe, or, you know, whatever. And then I'd just lie on the bed 15 minutes. I'd just say a few things about the opposite of what I was feeling, to make it positive. And then I just imagine myself in the exam, you know, being able to write well, structuring everything nicely, you know, normal values, definitions, and just doing something well, and then feeling the emotion that, oh yeah, I'm doing well, I'm learning, I'm growing. And these were the three things that I did pretty regularly for my first part exam. And interestingly enough, I didn't realize, but I had been doing this for years before. I played lots of sport, soccer, tennis, cricket. I would always, like, just like a child, thinking about the game, fantasizing about playing well in the game. I would do that constantly just as a joyful exercise when I was about to play a soccer game. And I realized that, oh, well, this is actually a natural state in me that, you know, why don't I do this for the more chore type things like an exam? And these days, I think, you know, the exam was definitely difficult stuff, but now, you know, I run a lot of education online, and every time I do a new course or change something about the course, I definitely feel the imposter syndrome and, you know, is this going to be useful? And then I just visualize, I just go, you know what, I'm just going to try my best. Hopefully I'll get lots of engagement. And I just talk myself and visualize out of that bad and negative self-talk to actually get it to the point that now when I feel any kind of anxiety, that's a signal that I'm about to do something useful. Because if I feel anxiety, that means that my body's telling me that you're about to challenge yourself. And on the other side of that, and I think you guys will all agree, every time you felt anxious about some kind of event, on the other side of that, you felt incredible relief and joy and happiness because you've got through that. And I just, you know, just now think about all those times, whether it's your year 12 exams and how you did well, or maybe, you know, you ran a marathon and you were pretty nervous about that, or maybe you were a competitive athlete or a musician having to perform, you would have felt incredible nerves. And at the end of that, imagine that real great thrill or relief and the achievement that you felt. So make that the same thing for this exam. That, like, it doesn't have to be different. So yeah, imagine being in the written or the viva and recalling, writing, and verbalizing answers in a logical, methodical, stepwise way. The examiner's nodding, happy with you. You want to present that to yourself. And I know from the examiners who've mentioned this, when you get a candidate who has that energy and charisma and positivity, that's a far better state for the examiners to want to give you marks than a withdrawn, negative person. And there's a lot of stuff about body language and that first impression type stuff that's important as well. Again, feeling the emotion, contentment, energy, motivation, excitement, concentration, and focus. Again, great emotions, great mental states to be in when you're in this exam. And these are things you have to practice, especially when your biology wants to go the other way. So why not try to hack this and train it the other way? So the next thing is cognitive behavioral therapy. And I've got this special tea bear here because this is the mnemonic that I use. Does anyone have any experience with CBT? Like, you might have studied it in a psych rotation or whatever. Does anyone know much about it? Because if you do, then I will. I'm definitely not an expert at this. Okay, this is one of those really, really useful therapies. So first of all, I'm not a CBT professional. There's a lot of fantastic people out there, you know, obviously psychologists who train specifically in CBT. And it's you know, one of the best evidence-based strategies for stress and anxiety, along with mindfulness and along with some medications as well, but we won't go through those. So first of all, T-Bear, trigger, belief, thought, emotion, acceptance, and refutation. I've added acceptance there because I think that's a really useful thing. And mindfulness is really one of those things that allows you to be aware of all points of this. Now, let's just go through them now. So the trigger, that's kind of obvious. You know, what caused the emotional state that you're feeling? Did you do a viva and you just couldn't get the answers? Did someone tell you that you were dumb and you should have got that? Maybe you wrote out a question and it was, you know, you just did a really poor answer. But what was the trigger that caused the emotion? In the exam, it's probably easier to be aware of this, but in real life, often something can happen and you won't even realize why you're feeling a bit annoyed, jealous, sad, whatever. So mindfulness really comes into play because you want to be able to be aware of it and acknowledge it. So that's pretty easy. Following that, you usually have an emotion. Oh, sorry. So before that, you have a belief or a thought. And that's easy because the trigger makes you think of something. Again, mindfulness makes sure that you're aware of what it is you're thinking. And then again, mindfulness will allow you to, you know, analyze your emotions. What emotions are you feeling, and acknowledge it as well. Now, I've added on acceptance because the reality is that whatever emotion or thought or, you know, bad state you're feeling, you know that this will pass. Imagine the last good or bad thing that happened to you. Maybe, you know, you just couldn't get that tube in, or maybe you were late to work and someone got angry at you, you know, something happened in your life. The next day, like, you know, in that minute, in that hour, you felt pretty crap. The next day, you wouldn't even have noticed it. So you know for a fact that this bad state will pass. And I find that really useful. I find normalization, the fact that many people have failed an exam, done a question badly, turned up late to work, whatever it is, this is not just you. You can forgive yourself for this. It is normal. It's part of just the condition of humanity. And then reframe it. You know, the fact that you've got something triggered, a thought and an emotion, but the fact that, why is that even a bad thing? The fact that you feel jealousy, the fact that you feel anxiety, why is that bad? Struggle is good. You know this. Would you rather be the person who's never had any hardship in their life? What does that person look like at the end of their life versus someone who's just taken on challenges like medicine, like anesthetic training, like the first part exam, and you've gone through some tough stuff. And at the end of it, you're that person who's completely strong and resilient. I know who I'd want to be. And I think that's really important to keep that into perspective, that you want these struggles and you want this exam and you want these challenges. And finally, the refutation or the rationalization. So what is the evidence for that thought you had? You know, you didn't do an SAQ particularly right. You think you're dumb. What is the refutation for that? So what's the evidence for why you think you might be not performing well or dumb? What would someone else tell you? What if it happens? You know, what is so bad about being dumb? Like, what does that actually mean? Is it going to make your life different in a week, month, or a year? And what are the pros and cons of thinking this way? So I thought we'd go through. So this is, in summary, this is all the steps. I thought we'd go through some of the, some examples of, and maybe come up with an example that you've had yourself. So, for example, I remember doing SAQs with a study mate, and he was phenomenally good at this, far better than I was, because I hadn't started exam practice, because again, I was afraid of that exam focused study, and his answers were just so much better than mine. So I felt crap. So my trigger was doing the SAQs, but the belief was I'm dumb. I'm just not good enough. The emotion was probably anxiety about this exam, maybe a bit of sadness. And then my ability to get through it means that I can accept it. Look, you know, I haven't studied as much. What would someone else tell me in that situation? Would they tell me that I'm dumb? You know, what's the evidence for that? I've got into med school. I've got into anesthetics. I've done well at everything else I've tried in life. And this one question made me feel a bit sad. That's completely, completely ridiculous. And then, and that's your refutation. What are all the reasons why this could possibly be true or not? Now, just think, you guys have already started studying. Do you have an experience that you could break down? Let's go through one. Anyone can kind of volunteer. So that's about a minute. And, you know, just to let you know, like as soon as I learned this strategy, this is something I use constantly. As soon as, so mindfulness practice makes sure I'm aware of stuff. So as soon as I feel like a negative state, I go, okay, what was the trigger for that? Great, I know the trigger. And often, like we mentioned, acknowledging an emotion makes that emotion less. The observation or the awareness of fear makes fear less. The awareness of sadness makes sadness less. The awareness of anxiety makes anxiety less. So I would go through this on a day-to-day basis, because you will have constant little things occurring and just go, oh, what caused it? Okay, what do I believe about it? Oh, what's that emotion? Great, I feel a little bit anxious. And, you know, I know this will pass. Great. Refutation, well, you know, do I really need to be anxious about this? This patient will be fine. This situation will be okay. I'm still a good person, all of that. You know that many other people have felt this way. I think, you know, every single person here or in the history of time sitting an exam has come back to a thing that they just couldn't remember. I just know that's true. So that's normal. And you know that this, in fairness, that concept, the fact that you know you're going to come back to it, you probably will eventually remember it. So you know that this will pass. And again, you know that this is a good thing. The fact that this exam is hard, you can reframe it, that you know, the struggle is good. So the emotion of anxiety, I think, you know, what would someone else tell you about that? They'll probably say it's okay, that they felt it before. What if it happens? What if it happens that you don't remember that concept? Is it so bad? One concept that you can't remember, it's actually probably very forgivable. It's not the end of the story. Is it going to make your life that different? You know, not remembering that one thing, like that one thing is probably very rarely going to be the sign of a failure of an exam. And it's far better. I mean, your thinking isn't too, you know, distorted or anything. The pros and cons of thinking this way, that, you know, you'll never remember it. Like, you probably realize that the reality is that you will eventually remember it once you've, you know, got a new strategy and you just keep plugging away at it. Again, I'm not a CBT trained professional at all, but if you think that's useful, you know, I really recommend you finding a psychologist or a professional who's really good at that. And again, it's just such a logical way of stepping through something, ties really well into mindfulness as well. And again, these are two of the three most evidence-based ways of dealing with stress, anxiety that all of us are going to face doing any kind of the high-end stuff that we're doing in life right now with anesthetics and training and exams. Look, the final section that we're going to go through is Stoicism. And this is something that, you know, really just came across in the last couple of years. These are a couple of the interesting things that have come out of Stoic philosophy. So dichotomy of control, journaling and gratitude, practicing misfortune, sounds a bit odd, training perceptions, negative visualization, and amor fati. And of course, they come with some really fancy sounding words to make you sound smart as well, which is always useful. Now, just to go through this dichotomy of control. So I've got a couple of quotes through this because they actually just sound really nice. The chief task in life is simply this: to identify and separate matters so that I can say clearly to myself which are externals not under my control and which have to do with a choice I actually control. Where then do I look for good and evil, not to uncontrollable externals, but within myself to the choices that are my own? And there's a few of these philosophers from back in the day who really embody Stoicism, and Epictetus, Marcus Aurelius, Seneca, you'll see quotes from them throughout this. So focus on what you can control on doing the exam. And I think you, again, you'll all be able to realize that you can have a study plan. You can study for 1 to 2 hours per day, depending on how much time you have on that day. You can collaborate with people and set up time frames and study schedules. And you can practice active recall. You know, these are just some examples of things that you can do to improve your performance, but you can't control the examiners. You can't control the way they're going to be and worry about them at all. You can't worry about the questions that are going to be on the test or your marks compared to others and how they're doing. These are things you just can't control. So I thought I'd just run through these. But again, there's a lot of good stuff on Stoic philosophy. I think William Irving has a really good book out about that. And again, listening to an audiobook on the way to work is a very low bar for entry into this kind of stuff as well. Interestingly, journaling was something that all of these very different men, you know, very different lives did. One habit was journaling. And I think you'll find that especially for this exam, but also for the rest of your life, is very useful. And so what Seneca used to do, favorite time was, this particular article talks about journaling in the evenings when darkness had fallen and his wife had gone asleep. He explained to a friend, "I examine my entire day, go back over what I've done and said, hiding nothing from myself, passing nothing by." Then he would go to bed, finding that the sleep which followed this self-examination was particularly sweet. And I thought about, you know, has journaling or reflection helped you, and how can it be useful for this exam? And I know that I did this accidentally, that I used to always review the day's lessons, and I'd write them down on just this crappy piece of A4 paper, which was literally the progress notes from my training hospital. And I just write down the things that I'd learned, and just the process of having that written down was very useful. And you can review and learn from the wins and the challenges. And this grew to a whole set of notes that just didn't even matter to anyone else but me, because it's what I learned that day. And also during my quick care year, did the same thing. I just had, you know, a logbook where I wrote down some stuff. And then in the nighttime, I'd go and just transfer it as a logbook onto an Excel sheet. And it's just the process of thinking about it and reviewing it that I think meant that I felt like I had a really fast learning curve. And I think that could really work with this as well. Finally, gratitude goes really well with journaling. It's something a bit different. And I really recommend this book called The Resilience Project by, I think it's Melburnian as well. So for this Resilience Project, he's got a really great story. He was a cricketer. He became a teacher, then went to work in Nepal, and just saw some really simple things that the Nepalese children were doing that made them incredibly happy. Whereas, you know, at home, we just have very much more complicated lives. So his system was to write down 3 things that you're thankful for today and write down 3 things that you're looking forward to tomorrow. And that's something, again, if you're going through some tough stuff, just again, occupying your thoughts with the good stuff is so much better than occupying it with the bad stuff. You don't owe your mind bad stuff to think about. You know, things like this, just try it out. Sometimes you won't use it all the time, but maybe when you're going through hard periods, you will find journaling and gratitude something that you can really work well together with. Now, practicing misfortune sounds a little bit odd. So it is in times of security that the spirit should be preparing itself for difficult times. While fortune is bestowing favors on it, is then time for it to be strengthened against her rebuffs. That's from Seneca. So emotions like anxiety and fear have their roots in uncertainty and rarely in experience. Just remember that often going the lead up to the exam or the event, you feel far more anxiety. And by the time you're in that moment of being tested, practice exams, whatever it is, you're feeling more energetic than anything. You've felt the adrenaline rush. So really it's all that uncertainty that manifests these negative emotions. So the solution is to do something about that ignorance and make yourself familiar with things and the worst case scenarios that you're afraid of. And this is something I do literally daily when I go into a case. I don't believe in jinxing. If I've got a lap collie, I'll just run a scenario with the reg or the anesthetist and go, hey, what happens if there's a troker in the vessel? What do we do? And we just plan for it. We've already rehearsed for it. And if it happens, great. Perfect. I remember doing a lot of simulation as a fellow, and it was just this really weird thing where I'd do the simulation and then either that afternoon or the next week, the event would happen. It was a anaphylaxis or a uterine rupture. And it was just that accidental preparation of sim and already running through the worst case scenario meant these arrests and these problems, and grade four airways just ran really well because you're ready. So this is also something you can do with the exam. So what can we do to face this exam? Do full practice exams. You'll see that they're not that bad. You'll get training for it. You'll get the endurance in your hand. You know, get vivas from people and stuff them up. Do them badly, and that's completely fine. You know, progress, not perfection. Each failure is the road to success. Ask to be grilled and ask for feedback. Just know that a lot of your examiners or practice examiners and your colleagues and your supervisors and consultants, they're not trained to give feedback. And I think the best way to do it is to be on the front foot and say, hey, I've got a thick skin. I want you to give me really good critical feedback, because then you're prepared for it. You know, you want that kind of response. You don't want people to tell you wishy-washy things about this. Once you do that, you're practicing misfortune. You'll see that it's just not the worst thing in the world. I don't know if anyone's done a half marathon. I remember most of my training for a half marathon was literally just hill sprints, and 8 hill sprints were so much more painful than a half marathon that it, you know, the half marathon just felt really easy after that. So practice the hard stuff while it's not that important. Train perception. So choose not to be harmed and you won't feel harmed. Don't feel harmed and you haven't been. The impediment to action advances action, and what stands in the way becomes the way. So this is from Marcus Aurelius. So again, this exam has ample opportunities to face challenges. And so what are they? Well, you know, each failed question is a path to a better answer. Every misunderstanding, you know, becomes better understanding. There's no way to get through this without lots of failures and lots of misunderstandings. And the problem is that we haven't faced probably this level of misunderstanding or failure or lack of knowledge in any of our lives, because this exam is a marathon of study. So, you know, just remember failure equals progress, and your perception of that is everything. So you have negative visualization, or let me try to get this word right, premeditatio malorum. So we should project our thoughts ahead of us at every turn and have in mind every possible eventuality instead of only the usual course of events. Rehearse them in your mind: exile, torture, war, shipwreck, and all the terms of our human lot should be before our eyes. And that's from Seneca. Obviously, we don't have to face torture and shipwreck, fortunately. But, you know, first of all, problems are still real problems. You have this exam as the most privileged, lucky people on the planet ever in the history of time. But the anxiety and stress that you feel is real. And if you think about the negative things that could have happened for this exam and in your life in general, I think it's surprising how good it can feel. Right now, imagine the fact that your plumbing actually works and your floor isn't flooded. That's just, you know, just think about how bad your life would be right now if that was the case. Or, you know, you get into your car to go to work and you start the car and it doesn't start. Or your microwave doesn't work when you're about to make a really nice meal. Any of these things, you will be filled with relief knowing that, you know, they actually exist. So I find this is a really nice little hack to just stay on the bright side of things. Just imagine this could be a lot worse than it is, and suddenly it's bad. And let's say something bad does happen. Imagine your house is flooded with, you know, the water pipes bursting. Imagine how relieved you would feel if it was water pipes and not sewage pipes. And it's just, again, one of those things that you can take home. Negative visualization is a really good instant hack for feeling a little bit better. Finally, amor fati. So to love only what happens, what was destined, no greater harmony. So do not seek for things to happen the way you want them to. Rather, just wish what happens the way it happens, and then you'll be happy, from Epictetus. So treating each and every moment, no matter how challenging, is something to be embraced, not avoided, to not only be okay with it, but love it, be better for it, so that, you know, like oxygen to fire obstacles and adversity, become fuel for your potential. So again, just a really good attitude to have. Whatever happens, whether you fail or pass the exam, know that in a few years' time, you'll be fine. You've gone through that struggle for something better. I hope you can see that there's obviously a lot of overlap with this stuff, but obviously really good things to have just written on your walls to keep perspective as you're going through this. I think the final thing that's just so important and just the easiest source of happiness, and that's something that's so already ingrained in ourselves, that your friends, family, and your colleagues, they're an incredible source of support and resilience. You know, keep regular social connection, share your struggles, you know, share your vulnerability at this point. You know, with my friends and my relationship, I remember saying, look, this is going to be a pretty hard time for me in the next 12 months. I'll be able to only see you this many times, but I, you know, I'm going to go through some hard stuff and I'll really need your help. Being able to say that to your mates and your loved ones, I think, you know, I don't think there's anyone who's going to reject that as a call for help, to be there for you. So I think it's really important to prep your friends and colleagues and family. and then come out stronger for sharing that experience with that person. Obvious things like seeking help from a GP or psychologist. It's an integral part of your health and well-being. You know, have a regular GP that knows you well and see them at least yearly or more frequently in the tough times. And then, you know, why is it that people speak to psychiatrists and psychologists when they're unwell? Surely there's this room for speaking to them when you're well and prepare and plan for future challenges. You know, get a sense of what your personality is like. A lot of you will be type A personalities, high performing, want the best, have levels of stress and anxiety that people that aren't doing medicine don't have. And so why not prepare for those things? So yeah, in summary, look, we've just gone through a very small part of the whole structure, the values and identity, knowing your life mission, who you are and what who you want to be, and then the well-being stuff. So mindfulness, mental optimization, you know, keeping perspective, affirmations, visualizations, emotions, things that you can drill throughout the day, cognitive behavioral therapy and the T-Bear strategy, stoicism, gratitude, and then your other common supports, you know, friends, GP, psychologist. Again, the way I use these techniques is really, it's a regular habit process now. You know, I've got waking up as an app, I can turn it on or just do meditation as I need to. Keeping a notepad, which becomes a logbook, gratitude journal, and you can write down the bits of Stoic philosophy that, you know, resonate to you. And also if you have the something that does happen, using that CBT type system to rationalize it and move on from it. And then share this stuff with your group, study group, family and friends. So look, we come to the end of that part of the session for today. Did you have any questions about any of that? I'll just go through. So these are the apps, you know, Waking Up, Guided Meditation, Headspace, and also Smiling Mind and Karma, the other apps that are available just to help you with meditation. I find the Waking Up app and Headspace particularly amazing because they've got these beginner courses and just all the basics of meditation, if that's something you're interested in. Yeah, really useful reads to give perspective on productivity and just overall values and perspective. And then this was a course that I did during the first lockdown. Again, really useful. This is the most popular course in Yale. It's an online course called Science of Wellbeing, and it goes through a lot of the stuff talking about how to just live a better life through evidence-based strategies. And it's actually a pretty easy course to do as well. I might do a whole talk just on this because it's so interesting.
Oh, yeah, no, that's all right. I was just going to say, no, thank you so much. And, you know, it's just the tip of the iceberg in terms of what I guess can be a sort of achieved in this space. And, you know, you are at the forefront of this in medicine. And, you know, you think about professional sports and how they are so advanced in terms of mind training and making sure that, you know, the athlete is not just optimally sort of prepared in their body, but also in their mind as well. And I think that's the whole basis of what I think, you know, we're all on about, that, you know, we are doctors and you know, we need to take care of ourselves, not just in terms of our body, but also of our mind as well. And, you know, thank you so much for being at the forefront of this and really sort of pushing, you know, just the wellness and the mindfulness and just, you know, that the care sort of that we need to look after ourselves as we pursue this really difficult goal for the primary exam. So thank you, Lark.
No worries at all. Thanks, Dan, for having me on. Cheers.